So this is lecture 35. So looks like it's in the middle of several other lectures going on in parallel. Okay, so like I said, the next few things we'll be talking about are practical things that are always done that you'll always see in many receivers, which are basically change in the structure of the implementation as opposed to the change in the implementation itself. So all the filters and everything you derive according to the formulation that we have, and then when you actually implement them, you might want to change the structure a little bit so that it works out better for you. So that's motivated from a practical point of view. One of the first such structures is what's called fractionally spaced equalizers. Okay. So far what we've been looking at is you have a received signal R of t. It gets I guess it gets demodulated. Okay, after that, what you do is you do a match filtering, right? You're in complex baseband and you do a match filtering. That's the ideal front end. And then you do symbol rate sampling. Okay, so this is at symbol rate. So we also saw when you design transmit pulses, you want to try to meet the Nyquist criteria. So typically people try to design square root raise cosine as a transmit pulse. Okay, and to have the pulse die down very fast, you also use some excess bandwidth beyond 1 by 2 t. Okay, so for 1 by t, 1 by 2 t is what's needed, and then if you use a sync, then 1 by 2 t is good enough, but sync doesn't die down very fast. So to make everything easier, you want to make it die down fast. So you use a little excess bandwidth. Okay, so more than 1 by 2 t. Okay, so in theory there is no problem, even though you're using more bandwidth than 1 by 2 t. Okay, so the transmit pulse basically uses excess bandwidth. Okay, what do I mean by excess bandwidth? So roughly it's some 1 plus alpha by 2 t for alpha greater than 0. Okay, but remember, what is after filtering, what is your sampling rate? It's 1 by t. Okay, so this implies sampling rate for your signal is 1 by t. Okay, so but you've adjusted the aliasing so carefully so that after aliasing you have a completely flat response. Okay, but nevertheless the sampling is going to introduce aliasing. If your channel was ideal, then one can argue maybe you won't have any problems. But if your channel is not ideal and your careful aliasing is, well, still okay, but still if the aliasing is then it becomes a little bit out of control. You can't control the aliasing very precisely. Okay, you're doing H star of F, but still the aliasing can cause trouble. Okay, so in practice that turns out to be a problem. Okay, so in general, people who process signals like to process at least Nyquist rate of the bandwidth. If you're occupying 1 plus alpha by 2 t, you want to sample so that you can reconstruct your signal if you want to. Okay, you never want to sample a signal which you cannot reconstruct, right? So the way if the aliasing has worked out correctly, you can recover the symbols properly and nicely with the nice detector. But nevertheless, you can never really reconstruct your signal because you've already caused aliasing and it's gone for a toss. Okay, so it's useful at least at the front end to sample at slightly more than symbol rate, and typical choice is to sample at twice the symbol rate. Okay, so the reason is you always assume an excess bandwidth of alpha is less than 1, right? So you always pick alpha between 0 and 1. So the maximum bandwidth you'll ever go to is 1 by t. Okay, so you sample at 2 by t so that your first sampling is Nyquist. Okay, so typically, so that's where the fractionally spaced equalizers come in. Okay, so equalizers that work with two times the symbol rate are called fractionally spaced equalizers. So within the symbol you're sampling twice. Okay, so that's the first way of motivating fractionally spaced equalizers. But there's also one more problem which makes fractionally spaced equalizers much more practical than merely looking at Nyquist rate and being able to reconstruct the signal. One can argue, why do you want to reconstruct the signal? I'm only interested in the symbols. I may not want to reconstruct the signal. Okay, so let me write down what the first motivation is. First motivation for 2 by T sampling is that 1 by T sampling cannot result in reconstruction, cannot be used to reconstruct your signal. Okay, so that's part of it. So you want to sample fast enough so you can do that. But that's only part of the reason. The more important reason is that. Yeah, so you may not want to reconstruct. I'm just giving you an idea. Whenever you want to do DSP, you want to do sampling without any aliasing, right? So people might want to do that. That's one reason. The other real reason is, if you're doing symbol rate sampling, so this is, here's another problem with symbol rate sampling. Okay, so you assume that the sampling time KT is exact. Okay, so you always assume KT is precise. Okay, so you know exactly where to sample, there's no delay, no other delay, etc. But in practice, there'll always be an unknown delay. Okay, so and you will never know when to sample exactly. Okay, so people who are doing the lab can attest to that. So there'll always be all kinds of delays, and you can't really do anything about it. You have to pretty much do trial and error, right? So when you have such kind of uncertainty in the timing, you might really want to sample fast enough so that you can reconstruct your signal and be precise about the timing later on. Okay, so that's why the timing is the real issue. Okay, so if KT is not precise, assume KT is precise. So if we assume, typically you assume KT is precise, but this may not be true. Okay. In practice, this may not be true. And if this is not true, then you can never get back your timing. So I'll show you some problems because of the KT not being precise. Suppose your H of T, that your match filter is H star of minus T, right? Suppose the H of T which is coming in has been delayed by T naught. Okay? And you don't know the T naught and you're continuing to sample at KT. Okay? So you have not adjusted for the T naught in your match filter. If you adjust for it in the match filter, everything will be fine. But if you don't adjust for it in the match filter, there's a delay in your H of T and you don't know for it. But and you're sampling at KT, you'll see the problem is to look at the folded spectrum, right? I want to look at the folded spectrum here. Remember, my entire equalizer will adapt to the folded spectrum. And if the folded spectrum is nice and flat without too many variations, then I know my filter will adapt and I'll be able to equalize reasonably okay. And if the folded spectrum has some nulls in the frequency, or if it's varying a lot, then I'll never be able to adapt for one, and maybe my noise enhancement will be so large that my performance will be very bad. All these things can happen particularly in MMSE implementations of DFE. Okay, so this can happen since MMSE DFE is what people may be using mostly. Such kind of problems can happen, and the folded spectrum needs to be well behaved. Okay. So in the previous case, we knew the folded spectrum was nice and it was at least non-negative, real, etc. Okay. So here, let's try to compute the folded spectrum. If you try to compute it, you get some interesting answers. So if you want to compute the folded spectrum there, e power j 2 pi f t, what do I need? It's going to be 1 by t summation, m equals minus infinity to infinity. Okay. And then I need the spectrum at this point. What is the spectrum at that point? Yeah, so there is an e power minus j 2 pi f t multiplied by h of f multiplied by h star of f. Okay, so I have to alias that. Okay, that is the spectrum which is going to be aliased. So I'll have e power minus j 2 pi f minus m by t naught, right, times h of f minus m by t times h star of f minus m by t. Okay, so this is going to be the folded spectrum. Okay, and if you see this, you will have first of all e power minus j 2 pi f t naught outside divided by t summation m equals minus infinity to infinity mod h of f minus m by t squared times what? e power j 2 pi m t naught by t. Okay, so this is what the folded spectrum works out to. First of all, the folded spectrum now is not real anymore. Okay, so it doesn't work out to be real, because of course you're not matching properly, so it won't work out as real. And definitely positive, negative, we can never say. It can go to zero in modulus. It can go to zero. We never know what's going to happen. Okay, a useful way to look at it is to assume that your bandwidth is limited to 1 by t, which will happen mostly. Okay, so even if you use 100% excess bandwidth, bandwidth is going to be limited to 1 by t. And then I'm only interested in, if I want to find s of e power j omega, and if I'm interested in omega between 0 and pi, f has to go from 0 and 1 by 2t, right? 1 by 2t is what I'm interested in. In that interval, I can quickly find the exact aliased signal. Okay, so here is what happens if you do that. What happens is this. Okay, so I'm going to quickly write it down and let's see what happens. So it turns out if you do Sz of, well, S, there's no Z, S of e power j omega from this, right? I put omega equals 2 pi ft and look at f between 0 and 1 by 2t. Okay, if I do that, S of e power j omega becomes, well, you have a e power minus j omega t naught by t times 1 by t, should be 1 by t, right? Yeah, the 1 by t is okay, it's not very relevant. You'll have a modulus h of omega by 2 pi t squared, okay? And then you'll have a term which looks something like this, 1 plus gamma e power minus j 2 pi t naught by t. Okay, and what is this gamma? So let me actually reproduce this on the next plot, on the next page. Okay, so this is what you get for the folded spectrum for f between 0 and 1 by 2t. You can check that. So you'll only have one aliasing term which will come from the one shift. Okay, so in fact gamma will depend on that. Gamma is nothing but modulus h of, well, f minus 1 by t squared divided by modulus h of f squared. Okay, so I've adjusted it so that this is f, okay? This is f. So I've pulled that one term out and I've written it down. Okay, so this is what you get, and this term, okay, 1 plus gamma, so this gamma is usually going to be is going to be between 0 and 1. Okay, so usually the gamma is going to be less than 1. Okay, so for most channels, so this 1 plus gamma times e power minus j 2 pi t naught by t is going to have a lot of fluctuations with depending on t naught. Okay, so it can really go down in magnitude depending on t naught. So I'll show you how that works out. So if you look at modulus 1 plus gamma e power minus j 2 pi t naught by t mod square, this will work out to 1 plus gamma square plus 2 gamma cosine 2 pi t naught by t. Okay, so you can do the simple computation. So you see, depending on t naught, for instance, if t naught is t by 2, then this becomes 1 minus gamma squared. So this is going to really cause a big dip in the way the frequency is going to behave. Okay, so basically the thing is, this is a function of t naught. Okay, so this s of e power j omega varies according to t naught, and the variation cannot really be easily quantified. If t naught is t by 2, it's going to be really bad. Okay, so it's going to go down significantly in magnitude. If otherwise, it may change in different ways. So you can't really control how this s of e power j omega is going to behave if you don't know t naught. Okay, and even if your original channel did not have any nulls, because of this t naught, you might have reductions at various points. Okay, so there might be fades and all that. Okay, so depending on how the t naught adjusts. Okay, so basically, moral of the story is, an unknown delay can cause bad spectrum. can result in a bad folded spectrum. Okay, and once you have a poor folded spectrum, first of all the match filter bound itself might be bad, okay, which means your equalizer itself is going to be quite bad, okay, and then you can't really, all your figures of merit will go for a toss if you're equalizing to a bad folded spectrum, okay. So you remember your generalized model is trying to equalize to some folded spectrum, right? So if that itself is bad, you can't do much. And secondly, if you're trying to adapt and if your folded spectrum has nulls, even that, there is a problem, okay. So your eigenvalues might go up to zero, so you'll have all kinds of instability problems, okay. So that's the main reason why symbol rate sampling, at least for the symbol rate sampling, is not preferred immediately after match filtering, okay, because you have no control over the timing phase. You cannot be very precise in your timing, and because of that you want to sample at least twice the symbol rate so that you have an option of being able to figure out, so that this timing phase problem goes away, okay. So because in that case there's no aliasing, right, this extra term won't come in if you do two times the symbol rate sampling. So this 1 plus gamma times factors won't be there, so T naught won't really cause that significant a problem, okay. It will only cause a delay, e power minus j omega T naught by T, and that you can deal with if you have Nyquist rate sampling. Your filter will roughly deal with it, you'll know exactly where to do the sampling, okay. You can do some adjustments in your receiver for that, okay. But if you allow the aliasing to happen, an unknown T naught will introduce factors like 1 plus gamma e power minus j T naught, which is going to give you a lot of fluctuations in your spectrum and a lot of problems, okay. So how do you overcome the problem? You overcome the problem by doing what's called fractionally spaced equalizers, okay. So remember, as far as performance metrics and structure is concerned, basically a fractionally spaced equalizer will exactly mimic any other symbol rate equalizer that you design for, okay. There is no change in the ideal case. The ideal case, when you know T naught or something else, there's no change. Only in practice, when you don't know these things and you're adapting for an unknown T naught and you're adapting for an unknown channel, all these things will play a part, okay. So structurally an FSC will be exactly the same as a DFE or something. In fact, it will do the exact same filtering. Conceptually it won't do any other change, but in practice when you adopt for unknown things, this is much more useful, okay. So here's how I'm going to derive the FSC. I'll start with the good old structure from before, where you have a match filter followed by a symbol rate sampler followed by I'll call it C1 of Z, which is your symbol rate equalizer. In the case of linear equalizer, that's the only filter. In the case of MMSE, in the case of DFE, it's going to be the precursor filter, okay. So I'll simply call it the precursor, the traditional precursor that you defined, that you derived using either what, the ZFLE or the ZF DFE or the MMSE-LE or the MMSE-DFE. You would have derived a precursor, that's the precursor, okay. So remember, in the precursor the assumption is what, your sampling time is ideal and all that. So that assumption has already been made, and in the adaptive version you adapt, okay. So depending on what happens, you get a filter, okay. So if you designing without any constraints on complexity, you would assume ideal sampling, exact sampling, no delay, etc. Delay has been compensated for, and you do it, okay. So the first change which is very interesting that people make is in this moving towards a fractionally spaced equalizer, is to push the precursor before the sampler, okay. So remember, the precursor is the one that's going to be most sensitive to this sampling function problem, okay, because you do most of the work. The postcursor, if at all it's there, it's going to be a causal filter and won't cause too much trouble. So the precursor is the one which is most sensitive to your sampling instant time. So you might, first thing you do is you push it to the left of the sampler. Of course, I have to sample again. I'm not going to do that in analog, okay. So that doesn't mean I'm going to implement the precursor in analog, okay. But I'm pushing it front, and then I'll do twice the symbol rate sampling before, so that I can comfortably do this design insensitive to timing phase. So it's a very simple shift, but just follow the argument, okay. So R of T, once again, gets multiplied by e power minus j 2 pi f c t. And then you have h star of f, okay. So what will this filter be? I'm going to call it C1 e power j 2 pi ft. Okay, followed by symbol rate sampling. And the assumption is the post cursor is not too sensitive to the to errors in this sampling. Okay, if you can manage to do this filter properly, the post cursor will not cause too much trouble. Okay, all these spectral nulls and changes are not a big trouble for the post cursor. Okay, you can go back and check that. Right. So now I want to implement these two filters at 2 times the symbol rate. The reason is then I won't cause any aliasing and my timing phase is no problem. I don't have to worry about being exact about the timing phase when I do. It's not insensitive, it's not as sensitive as the precursor. Precursor is the one where you really do the, so if you go back and look at your MMSC DFE design, you get the 1 by M stars and nasty stuff only in the precursor. Postcursor, you mostly get causal, just nothing, the zero term is not there, it's just a causal filter and it will usually be stable. You can go back and look at many of the examples that you did. Usually it will be a simple nice filter, won't cause any problems. Okay. So here's what you do. So to make this insensitive, the whole thing insensitive to any timing problems, what usually is done is you do R of t multiply by e power minus j 2 pi f c t. You put an anti-aliasing low pass filter. Okay, so this is pretty much an anti-aliasing filter. Okay, so maybe the bandwidth is 1 by t. Yeah, that's a good bandwidth to pick. And if you know the excess bandwidth exactly, you can even pick 1 plus alpha by 2t. So throw away everything else. And then you sample at kt by 2. Okay, so twice the symbol rate. So you know you've done an anti-aliasing filter and then you've done Nyquist rate sampling. So basically more than two times the bandwidth is your sampling frequency. So you can have exact reconstruction of the signal that came in. And then you're doing filtering. But now I'll simply write it as one filter at e power j pi f t. Okay, why don't I have the 2? Because now I'm at t by 2. Okay, so I've adjusted that. So what will happen to your frequency when I do 2 times the samplings? Because of that, the axis will change. Okay, before and after the symbol rate sampler. So you should adjust for that very carefully. And then you sample at k t. Okay, so what is the c of e power j pi f t? This will work out to h star of f times c1 e power j 2 pi ft. Okay. So when you do 2 times, you will have 2 versions of the lower rate, right? So that's how the thing will come. So you must have studied this. It's called the standard upsampling procedure, right? So this equation is important. Pay some attention to it. If you've not understood it, there is some reasonable amount of DSP involved here. Why do I get the pi ft for the c inside and j 2 pi ft for the c1? Okay, so originally I designed the c1 of z assuming symbol rate sampling. Then I'm moving it inside and then I'm actually sampling twice. Okay, so what happens there is an important thing to pay attention to. Okay, so basically from here to here, these two structures are exactly same in the ideal case. What is the ideal case? When you sample, when your symbol rate sampling is exact and precise, there's no delay to work out for, no problem, and your sampling phase is exact, then these two are exactly the same. But in the non-ideal case, when T0 is unknown, this fractionally spaced equalizer will work much, much better. Okay, because your spectrum after the anti-aliasing filter, and if you do KT by 2, is well controlled. There is no aliasing from something else with an unknown T0 to push it down or push it up or do some crazy things. Okay, it's very well controlled. You know exactly what you're doing, and this filter is happily working at with no aliasing. So there's no, it's not very sensitive to any timing problem. You can do a nice filtering, and then you do a symbol rate sampling. Okay, so there's no problem. Right, now remember this symbol rate sampling. You have to pick either for every symbol there are 2 points that you have to pick. You have to either pick one or the other. Okay, and then usually there is a timing recovery loop which will tell you which point to pick. And sometimes if one point is not good enough, you push to the other. There's always a little slip that happens in timing recovery there. So you can work with the two samples per symbol to decide which one you want to pick usually. Okay, so any questions on this? Okay, so this is a fractionally spaced equalizer. Okay, the first point I want to point out is deriving a fractionally spaced equalizer is not any more complicated than all the derivations you have already done. Okay, you already know, given the folded spectrum, how to derive the zero forcing linear equalizer, zero forcing DFE, MMSC LE and MMSC DFE. Okay, you just take the precursor from there, move it to the left and blindly use this formula. You will get the filter needed inside the for the fractionally spaced equalizer. Okay, that's the first point. So no separate derivation is necessary. The same derivation will quickly tell you the answer for the fractionally spaced equalizer as well. That's the first point. The second thing is, the fractionally spaced equalizer fuses the match filter and the precursor into one filter. Okay, and the analog front end is simply what? A low pass filter followed by Nyquist rate sampling. Okay, so you see why such a structure is very attractive in practice. Okay, the analog front end usually has to be very standardized, because you don't want to design that based on the channel, etc. So you want to standardize it to a low pass filter at a certain frequency, right? If it's that standard, then any other change you want to make tomorrow, if you want to change the transmit pulse, right, you don't have to change the analog front end, it's still the same. It's only a firmware level change, if you want the technical language, right? There's no hardware change required. Anytime you need a hardware change, it's a complicated operation, can't do anything else. But if you're only changing the transmit pulse from a, which is inside, well, usually these things are sitting inside some digital processor inside your board, then there's no problem. You just change the firmware on that processor, everything will work. Okay, so that's why such a structure is more preferred today. So you just want to have a low pass filter, but you sample two times, you design a filter, it will work. Okay, so that's one of the many practical advantages of the fractionally spaced equalizer. Okay, so any questions? Is okay? See, unless actually, I think maybe if I give you a problem in the assignment and you actually work it out, maybe at that time it will be more clear. Okay, but again, ideally, you will not expect to see any difference. For instance, the figure of merit will be exactly the same as what you had before. So the ideal analysis and everything will be exactly the same. Nothing will change. In practice, with an unknown T naught, when you're trying to design a system, two times the symbol rate is way better than one symbol rate. Okay, so you'll see this, the not knowing the delay will cause a lot of problem. Okay, so you'll have to adjust for it a lot. Sometimes I think people are doing the lab, sometimes just stare at the signal and manually do the adjustment, right? So you may not be able to do it in practice, but if you have two times the symbol rate sampling, then it's convenient to do it. Okay, so that's the thing to keep in mind. Okay, so any other point I wanted to make? Yeah, so the next thing is about adaptation. Okay, so adaptation is a bit of an issue. Okay, so remember, your adaptation happens only at symbol rate. Why does the adaptation happen only at symbol rate? Yeah, the error is calculated only for one symbol. You can't calculate for an imaginary symbol once again in the middle. Okay, so the adaptation happens only at symbol rate, but one of your adapting coefficients is going to work at two times the symbol rate. So what do you do? Yeah, just drop every other sample that your precursor is outputting. Okay, so don't adapt for every alternate sample. So only adapt whenever you're actually making a decision. Okay, for the post cursor though, there's no problem. Post cursor is only working at symbol rate. If you have a post cursor is working at symbol rate, there's no problem. But the precursor is working at two times the symbol rate, so every alternate symbol you won't adapt. Okay, so you drop alternate sample, not symbol, sample. Okay, in your adaptation. So that's a very simple way to adapt. So that's the only modification. So remember, the CK plus 1 is CK plus beta EK ZK star. That still remains the same, but your precursor is producing one extra sample. So you just simply drop it. Take only the symbol rate samples and adapt. Okay, so the filter for the precursor will change only at symbol rate, won't change in any other way. Okay, but there's a more subtle problem. Okay, so because you did the anti-aliasing filter and aliased, and your precursor is working with a very good spectrum, it might also work with, if your excess bandwidth is less than 100%, okay, and you're anti-aliasing down to 1 plus alpha by 2t, and you're sampling at 2 by t, you will necessarily have 0 for some part. Okay, so your spectrum that the precursor has to adapt to will necessarily have 0. So what's the problem because of that? Well, the eigenvalues will go to 0. One of the eigenvalues will go to 0. Okay, so because of that, there might be some instability. Okay, so because of 2 by t sampling, this results in eigenvalues of phi going to 0. Okay, so there's lots of theory here about how to do adaptive filter. So this is the problem in adaptive filter design. Okay, so how do you adapt a filter when you know that this eigenvalues for phi are going to go to 0, this the correlation matrix. So that can cause some trouble. Okay, so that's one thing to be aware of in the adaptation. Okay, so there might be some instability because of that, but this is seriously not a problem. People can still deal with it. Okay, there's one more problem from practice, not from adaptation, but from a complexity point of view, that needs some attention. You have to pay some attention to. Okay, so when you were doing, suppose NTAP filtering with symbol rate. Okay, now your precursor has to, now your fractionally spaced equalizer is working at 2 times the symbol rate. Okay, so which means what? So what is the problem? If you once again stick to only NTAP for the precursor, you will be operating only over half the time duration. Right? Your NTAP in the symbol rate would have worked over n times t time. Over n times t time. Okay. But when you stick to the same number of taps with the fractionally spaced equalizer, you're working with t by 2. So you'll cut down to nt by 2. Okay. So but in spite of that, performance is comparable of these two things. Okay. So that's one thing. So to keep complexity low, same number of taps for two by t and 1 by t sampled versions. Precursors. Okay, to keep the complexity the same, you want to do that. Okay, otherwise your number of taps will go up, right? And you may not be able to do it, and this might cause some performance degradation. Okay, because your tail is not long enough, right, in your equalizer. But it's in practice, people have done simulations. I don't think you can analyze it without simulations. So you do simulations and you see that it works out. You pick some suitable number. There's so many other advantages that FSE gives you that you're willing to live with this disadvantage. Okay, so that's the other point to keep in mind. Okay, all right. So the fractionally spaced equalizer is one thing which is done in practice. One more thing which is done is what's called passband equalization. Okay, so let me talk about that very briefly without going into great detail. Okay. So oftentimes what will happen is when your R of t comes in and you multiply by e power minus j 2 pi. So typically I assume it is FCT, but you can never know that, right? You will never know whether it is FC or F1. Usually there is something called a carrier recovery loop which will adjust for it. Okay, so in your receiver, maybe I'll talk about it later, but you'll adjust for it. But in general, you might want to adjust for the, maybe you might want to adjust for the delta F between your F1 and FC. So if there is a delta F between your F1 and FC, maybe you want to adjust for the delta F inside your equalizer. Okay, so there are several cases in which this might be useful. Okay, so some cases what people do is the center frequency itself might be so high that you don't want to run a carrier recovery loop at that frequency. You want to run a carrier recovery loop at a lower frequency. Okay, so for that you might do some intermediate frequency conversion, but sometimes it's useful, maybe I'll justify it later when I draw the whole receiver. It's useful sometimes to put your carrier recovery at an intermediate frequency inside your equalization loop. Okay, so I'll show you how that is done. Okay, hopefully I'll be able to reproduce this exactly. Okay, so I'll show you just for the linear equalizer, the post cursor I won't show, only the precursor. Okay, so the precursor is going through, okay, well, I'm sorry, the post cursor is completely missing in this picture. So remember that post cursor also exists, but I'm just showing this real quick to motivate how this is going to work. So there's going to be an error calculated here, and that's going to feed here for adapting, right? This is how your typical equalizer design works. There's a loop here for adapting, okay? So now if there is a delta f, okay, and the slicer works without delta f, it's going to be big time confusion, okay? You see why there'll be confusion now, okay? So e power, so how will this show up? First of all, how will this show up here? Suppose this is some xk, right? And the xk, you expect it to be around the transmitted constellation. Suppose the transmitted constellation was, say, 4 QAM. The xk is going to fall, you expect, somewhere around here, right? And that's why you're slicing for the 4 QAM to get your x hat. S hat of k is what you're getting after the slicing, right? So now, if this would happen if delta f is 0. If delta f is not 0, what's going to happen? Xk is going to be this guy multiplied by e power j 2 pi delta f t. Okay, so you're going to get this xk is going to get multiplied by your xk is going to get multiplied by e power j 2 pi delta f t. Okay, in fact, even t is there. So t is going to be what? Kt. I'm sorry, should put kt here because you've already sampled it. So kt. Okay, so depending on k, what's going to happen? The rotation is also going to change. Admittedly, delta f will be small, it won't be very large, maybe some 0.001, but as you keep sending several symbols, they will slowly start rotating and you'll start getting points in a circle ideally, or maybe even in an ellipse if in some crazy situation. Okay, so you'll start getting rotations and you have to compensate for this rotation in your slicer, otherwise your slicer error will go for a toss and your equalizer coefficients will also nicely rotate. So you'll see they'll also follow some sine waves here and there. In the complex domain, they'll also rotate. So everything will be rotating. If your eigenvalues are not too bad and if you're catching up every time, you see the whole thing will keep on rotating if you don't adjust for it. Okay. So this is something you can check. I think people in the lab should check this. If you find a delta f, see what happens. You see everything will rotate. Everything will follow a sine wave. Okay. So moral of the story is, anytime you see a sine wave in baseband, what's the culprit? There is a delta f somewhere. Okay. So there's something has creeped up. Okay. So the way to adjust for it, okay, I'm running out of time. The way to adjust for it is what? If you know delta f, okay, assuming you know delta f, or you have some loop which is telling you what delta f is, okay? If there is some loop which is telling you what delta f is, okay? If you know that, then what should you do? You should multiply here with e power minus j 2 pi delta f t. Oh, kt, I'm sorry. Okay, then what should you do after the slicer? Once again multiply, because your error has to be calculated for the rotated version. Reason is your equalizer is working with the rotated version only, it's not working with the original one. So one more multiplication you put here, and then you say this is getting multiplied by g pa j 2 pi delta f k t. Okay, so this is something you'll have to put in a passband equalizer where you expect a delta f. Okay, so this delta f can be different depending on what your choice is. So this is a choice. So this is a practical choice that you might have to make sometime, depending on how your oscillators are in your receiver board and all these things. You might want to put some oscillators, not put some oscillators. So based on that, you might have to deal with the delta f inside your equalizer. In that case, you have what's called a passband equalizer and you deal with it in this way. Okay, there's an equivalent structure here where you can move the multiplication outside of the slicer loop. Move it outside of the slicer. Okay, so you'll see in later structures there's some use in moving it outside of the slicer, because then your post cursor will come inside the slicer. Your post cursor is not going to be affected by this, all this confusion and multiplication. Okay, so you might want to pull it out. The way to pull it out, I believe, is to take this multiplication, these two multiplications, and put them. Put one multiplication here, e power minus j 2 pi delta f kt, and put the other multiplication after the error, e power j 2 pi delta f kt. Okay, so it's equivalent to what I had before, except that I've pushed the multiplications outside of the slicer, moved them far away from the slicer. Okay, the slicer is not going to be affected that much by the multiplication. So the post cursor will be largely okay. It won't function depending on the delta f. You don't have to worry about the post cursor. Okay, so this equalizer structure is called a pass band equalizer. Okay, so I think I'm running out of time. I'll stop here. In the next class, I'll start by drawing a very elaborate receiver, which includes a fractionally spaced equalizer, includes the carrier recovery loop, includes a timing recovery loop, and post cursor, precursor, everything. Show you one big structure and talk about that a little bit. Okay, so we'll see that next class.